Hello, everyone. My name is Barbara Buch. I am the Associate Director for Medicine at the Center for Biologics Evaluation and Research at FDA. And today, as part of this ongoing series, we're going to talk a little bit about how sponsors can help with IND safety as part of their submissions. So it's really important to have timely reporting of this required safety information that I'm going to talk about today, because it allows FDA to understand and consider whether any changes in study conduct should occur beyond those that were already planned. And the sponsor can then also have a look back, and it allows investigators to make any changes that are needed to protect the subjects in their studies. And what we're going to talk about today is a systematic approach that will help sponsors with safety surveillance and also limits the scope of IND safety reports to FDA so they're not burdensome. But it also allows participating investigators to also get these subsequent reports to their institutional review boards and staff. This allows timely reporting of severe adverse reactions that are serious and unexpected, but it also allows all the parties to focus on important safety issues and take actions to minimize risks to participants in a clinical trial. So let's start a little bit with definitions. An adverse event is defined as any untoward medical occurrence associated with the use of a drug, biologic, or device in humans, whether or not it's considered related to the intervention. An adverse reaction is any adverse event for which there is a reasonable possibility that the drug, device, or biologic caused the adverse event. It's important to note that FDA helps sponsors by having available multiple guidances. And one of the ones that I'm recommending that you look at carefully is a guidance for industry and investigators, safety reporting requirements for INDs and BA and BE studies. Recently, as last year, FDA updated this guidance and it's called Sponsor Responsibilities, Safety Reporting Requirements, and Safety Assessment for IND and Bioavailability and Bioequivalence Study, a guidance for industry. This includes the 2012 guidance, but also updates it with several reporting aggregate information that is helpful for investigators. In addition, annual reports or information amendments might come in as required. There's also guidance associated with content of these reports. I'll go into that a little bit more in a moment. So for IND safety reporting, the regulation is 21 CFR 312.32. In it, it states that the sponsor must notify FDA and all participating investigations within 15 days in writing for serious and unexpected suspected adverse reactions. Findings from other studies or from in vitro or animal testing that suggest a significant risk for humans, including reports of mutagenicity, teratogenicity, or carcinogenicity, are also required for 15-day notice. And lastly, 15 days notice is required for increased rate of serious suspected adverse reaction over that listed in the protocol or investigator brochure, which may be known or unknown. For unexpected fatal or life-threatening suspected adverse reactions, FDA requires as soon as possible notification, but within 7 days by telephone or fax. These are also listed in the IND safety reporting regulations. Annual reports, as I mentioned, also contain safety information, and this is found in 21 CFR 312.33. These require summary safety data from ongoing and completed clinical studies, including the number of subjects planned and enrolled, including dropouts, the most frequent and most serious adverse experiences, a summary of IND safety reports submitted in the last year to the sponsor, and any deaths and probable causes. These reports also include a list of preclinical studies completed or in progress with a summary of major findings, a summary of significant manufacturing changes occurring since the last annual report or approval of the IND, A description of general investigational plans for the coming year, if they change or not. A copy of the investigator brochure, if revised, with a description of revisions. And foreign marketing developments. Any IND, as you know, will change over time, and these things help both the sponsor and FDA understand what's happening currently in the clinical trial. The protection of human subjects is also part of the responsibilities of the sponsor and of investigators. These are listed in detail in 21 CFR 56. Part of them include communication and discussion with an institutional review board. The institutional review board is any board, committee, or other group formally designated by an institution to review biomedical research involving humans as subjects, to approve the initiation and conduct, and to conduct periodic review of such research. This oversight board is important, as compliance is intended to protect the rights and welfare of human subjects involved in biomedical research in an ongoing basis. Under 21 CFR 50 and 56, the Institutional Review Board, or IRB, will review and approve all protocols, including any changes, to assure that the risks to subjects are minimized and are reasonable for the research. It also assures that the selection of subjects is equitable, and informed consent will be sought and documented for all participants. IRBs must have at least 5 members with varying backgrounds. They have the ability to review and have the authority to approve, require modifications, or disprove all research activities at the institution in question. The IRB are responsible for the adequacy and documentation of informed consent in clinical trials by investigators and sponsors. Most IRBs will conduct continuing review of research at least once a year, or as is needed, depending on the risk of a trial. The IRB must determine that the research is in compliance with special protections for children under Part 50, which I'll mention in a moment, and maintains the records of IRB activities, meetings, and decisions for at least 3 years after completion of the research. And the records from the IRB activities will be accessible for inspection and copying by FDA. Under 21 CFR 50, there are numerous informed consent requirements listed. This includes explanation of the purposes of the research, duration, and procedures for participants, a description of reasonably foreseeable risks to the subject and any benefits that may be afforded. It also includes disclosure of alternative procedures or treatments, if any are available. It will describe the extent to which confidentiality will be maintained and notes that FDA may inspect and copy records as needed for oversight. There also includes explanations regarding compensation and available medical treatments if injury occur and where additional information may be obtained by the participant. The informed consent also identifies contacts who may be called for answers to any questions or may be contacted in the event of research-related injury. And finally, informed consent requirements also require that statements for the study that participation is voluntary, and refusal to participate will involve no penalty or loss of benefits, and participation may be discontinued at any time without penalty or loss of benefits to the participant. Human subjects protections continue for children in the regulations in 21 CFR 50 subpart D. This includes additional safeguards for children in clinical investigations. Clinical research in children is approvable if not more than minimal risk, or there is prospect of direct benefit for the individual subject, or the research is likely to yield generalizable knowledge about the subject's disorder or condition, or if not otherwise approvable, but the research represents an opportunity to understand, prevent, or alleviate a serious problem affecting the health or welfare of children. In this last case, under 5054, the study must be referred to the FDA commissioner for panel review and discussion. Pediatric Research and Equity Act of 2007 and the FDA Safety and Innovation Act of 2012 further delineate pediatric research, commonly known as PREA. It requires a manufacturer of a drug or biologic who submits an application for marketing a new active ingredient, a new indication, a new dosage form, a new dosing regimen, or a new route of administration to submit a plan for assessment in pediatrics. This is called an initial pediatric study plan. An agreed initial pediatric study plan and data to be included as part of the planned application is required. An agreed IPSP is required prior to the submission of a new drug or biologics licensing application, NDA or BLA. Again, there is helpful guidance that will help you to construct this plan. This guidance is called the Pediatric Study Plan, Content of and Process for Submitting Initial Pediatric Study Plans and Amended Initial Pediatric Study Plans Guidance for Industry. And this was recently updated in August of 2020. The FDA Reauthorization Act, or FDARA, approved in 2017, and the RACE Act, approved in 2020, amends PREA relevant to cancer drug development, since assessments of efficacy in children for the same indication may be impossible. In this case, it requires evaluation of a new molecularly targeted drug or biologic intended for the treatment of adult cancers and directed at a molecular target that may be relevant to the growth or progression of a pediatric cancer when the subject of an initial NDA or BLA. This is different from the previously promulgated Pediatric Research Equity Act of 2007 and 2012. In general, pediatric plans contain a summary of planned non-clinical and clinical studies, plans for any pediatric specific formulation development, and a description of data needed to support initiation of pediatric studies. It also includes a timeline for completion. The goal is an adequate assessment of safety and effectiveness with dosing and administration in the relevant pediatric populations. Based on established criteria, however, FDA may also waive the requirement for immediate pediatric assessment for some or all age groups, or defer the timing of submission of some or all of the pediatric assessment. This is all outlined in detail in the guidances I mentioned. In addition, FDA just published in 2022 the ethical considerations for clinical investigations of medical products involving children, which provides additional guidance related to inclusion of children in clinical trials. And finally, I wanted to talk about the last puzzle piece in IND safety, and that's bioresearch monitoring. The regulations require insurance of the quality and integrity of data submitted to FDA to support an IND or IDE, a BLA or NDA, a PMA, or other applications. There isn't time today to talk in detail about what this involves, but it does involve special inspections and other data submission to ensure that the rights and welfare of human subjects are protected. That comes to the end of my discussion. I hope that you avail yourself all the available guidances for timely reporting of IND safety. Thank you for your attention.